Hi, and welcome back to another episode of World Beyond Belief. We are honored again this week to have Eric Karlstrom here. And we talked last week with him about climate change and how they're using the climate to deceive us and put us in a situation that we don't want to, where we don't want to go. This week, we're gonna talk about a kind of a different subject, but very much related. We're gonna talk about the New Age deception and how they've been working back since 1950s and even before, actually the whole 20th century, to try to get us into a mindset that allows us to be totally defenseless against things like culture disruption, climate change, and those things. So without further ado, let me introduce Eric Karlstrom. Thanks for coming, Dr. Karlstrom.
Well, thank you, Paul, and it's nice to be able to converse again through the magic of modern Skype,
right,
and see each other in our different continents.
Right.
And Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you, too. Okay, so let's start with, on your websites, you go back to the beginning. And how did this whole New Age milieu get started?
Okay, I just wanted, let me give a little background on that. I've got four websites.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
911nwo.com, which I started shortly after 911 because I could see, obviously, that it was fraudulent, that it eventually learned, of course, that it's state-sponsored terrorism, it is a false flag event, and it is synthetic state-sponsored terrorism, as so many other of these events are. And it very quickly I realized that it had something to do with the bringing in of the New World Order, hence the name for my URL, 911nwo.com. Now, I also have three other websites. One is naturalclimatechange.us, which actually plays right into my professional expertise as a physical geography professor. And I have done research on climates of the past, so I'm very well aware how much climate has changed naturally, and am quite aware that humans are having virtually no effect by driving their cars, because carbon dioxide is not, as is claimed, a major climate driver. It's a tiny, tiny bit player. Then I have another website, waterwatchalliance.us. And then finally, what feeds me, I guess, artistically, is I am a bit of a musician, and that music is featured on my erickarlstrom.com website. So those are my websites. And your question about the New Age movement really comes up. My research on this goes back to just several years ago when I started a series of articles entitled, Is Crestone Baca, where I live in Colorado, the Vatican City of the New World Order, ? An expose of the New World Religion. And since I live in Crestone Baca, and since a conservative columnist named Tom DeWeese made the charge back in 1996 at a talk he gave to a conservative group, he's with American Policy Committee or Institute, he said, Crestone Baca, Maurice Strong believes, is the Vatican City of the New World Order. Well, I mean, that's a pretty dramatic statement. And since I was starting to notice some very strange goings on in my little hometown with only 1,500 people, but well over 30 spiritual groups from all over the world, wow, that were brought there by Marie Strong's wife, Hannah, and the Manitou Foundation, to form a kind of a United Nations of religions, I started to investigate that question in order to understand what's going on there. And in the context of that research, I had to do an investigation of the New Age movement, you know, going back to Helen Blavatsky and the Theosophical Society and Alice Bailey, and then the Rosicrucians going back further, and the Freemasons, and all of these secret societies that have been kind of manipulating politics from behind the scenes for centuries, I think, in order to bring about their one world government, one world religion. And this is more or less the conclusion I've come to. But so the New Age movement then has real history. And of course, Hitler himself was very much into the Theosophical Society of Blavatsky. He was also part of the Tool Society, which is one of these occult, you might call it satanic, secret societies. Even C.G. Jung, the famous psychiatrist or psychologist, said, obviously, Hitler is possessed. I mean, this man is possessed. And that's where he got his charisma and his diabolical effectiveness. He was, I think, a shell of a man. And unfortunately, this seems to be part of what the New Age movement is about. It's a term called theurgy, which is summoning spirits. In other words, you know, I'm coming from a scientific point of view, but it does seem that there is a spiritual world as well. And we have been in our modern world kind of, I'd say, brainwashed intentionally into, you know, kind of looking in the wrong directions, like right. Global warming is going to get us, you know, yeah. Which is a complete fantasy and a fraud. And the Muslims did 9/11. You know, I mean, these are gigantic, I think, contrived, manufactured false reality matrices, which keep us from looking at things as they are. And the New Age movement, like you mentioned, does that. It I think, is designed to rob us of our rational, critical faculties. Nowadays, for instance, you can't, you're almost not allowed to question climate change or global warming because it's an article of almost religious faith, that kind of the centerpiece of the whole environmental movement. And what I've noticed talking to friends and people I meet, the more people watch NPR, the more they're well-educated, the more they tend to, quote, have a conviction about climate change. So they're more brainwashed.
Right.
So the smarter they are, the more educated, the more brainwashed. So we're in a very tough spot here. But yeah, so that's kind of an introduction to how I got into the New Age movement, to try to understand what this New World religion is about. I had to go back and look at the past a little bit. And then, of course, you come up to the present and you see, as you say, the political correct movement and campuses, you know, where you can't say anything that questions these things. Or else, if you're a professor, you could risk losing your job. Your student, right. You could be, criticized and called down by the professor, ridiculed even. So yeah, it's a kind of a mind control thing. And of course, I've written some articles about mind control too. So I think they all kind of tie in our modern world here.
The absolutely.
Mind control, yeah.
Well, we're considered climate change deniers, just like Holocaust deniers. Are you?
Yes, there's a whole book about that, the climate deniers. Which, of course, is a double lie, because of people like myself who actually have taught climatology and have taught quaternary environments, which is the quaternary being the last geological period of the last 2 to 3 million years. I mean, this is the story of the quaternary, is huge climate changes, you know, glacial, interglacial fluctuations, which are all natural. And so I would never deny that. In fact, that's what I taught, so I actually know something about climate change. But the senators, the congressmen, the Pope, the Dalai Lama, the people that were at Paris over there making their climate resolutions, Obama, these people know nothing about the climate system. And but they do know that there's a lot of money behind the proposition that right. We have committed tremendous climate injustice in the North by driving our cars, and therefore we need to make climate reparations to those right. Third world countries like India and China. So now, as a result of Paris, apparently the United States and other industrial countries are supposed to spend pay tens of billions of dollars to these third world countries. Well, this is an attempt by, you know, the global United Nations interests to bring the industrial countries down economically and to bring the third world up. So, you know, again, part of this one world agenda.
Yeah. So part of getting us involved and getting us to believe this man-made climate change, I call it a hoax, is the New Age deception and how they've used freedom of speech. How did they use that to help them with this climate change agenda? How does that fit together, Eric?
Well, this is a very interesting question, and you're really the first person, on this question about the New Age movement and global warming. I think that part of the New Age movement and all that goes with it is a just deep, deep, deep anti-intellectual trend. And when I recall many of my experiences, for instance, in Crestone, Colorado, where a lot of old hippies have landed and young hippies have migrated to, when Chief Arville Looking Horse of the Lakota Sioux comes and gives a talk at the local Colorado College auditorium, the room is packed. And, they'll be up there with some drums and, two or three attendants, and then the chief, who is he's just a civilian, but he's got this, I guess, mystique aura of being kind of a Indian leader or shaman, whatever. Anyway, he'll talk, and all of these Crestonians, maybe 50 or 60 or 100 of them, will be listening with bated breath, and he'll say things like, "I went out to the river behind my house, and I saw it was polluted, All these Westerners, are at his feet. Now, these Westerners have the benefit of a pretty good education, probably much better than he did.
Right.
And it's the same with the Tibetan masters, and we're just at their feet listening for, sage wisdom from them. We seem to have rejected our own educational input. And of course, since I, went on to get a Ph.D. and be a professor for 30 years, I noticed that, for instance, the locals put a lot more weight on what Chief Arville Looking Horse says than what I say. Nobody's asked me to give a talk about anything in Crestone. And yet, I taught for 30 years at universities. So there's a tremendous anti-intellectual backlash that goes along with the New Age movement. Tremendous. It's almost axiomatic that the university people are the bad guys. I'm a little sympathetic to where they're coming from because, of course, I went through the same kind of culture shocks that they did along the way that our generation did go through. But I have certainly not rejected the intellectual tradition. And you can't fight your way out of these, frauds like the climate, global warming fraud and the 911 fraud, unless you can think critically and read a lot of material and get a lot of alternative information. And then based on connecting the dots with all that other information, much of which has to be academic, because that is a systematic and right. formalized way of asking questions and getting answers. This is, I think, one way in which the New Age movement has disarmed people. As you put it, it's kind of crippled us from seeing these frauds.
Right.
And I think part of it is the politically correct thing. You can't question global warming because it's been sold to us like, for instance, a religion.
Right.
It is, the environmental movement is the religion, or feminism is the religion, or multiculturalism is the religion. These are the dogmas of the modern university.
Right.
When I was starting at California State University, Stanislaus, at 1990, feminism was the dogma. And if you were, foolish enough to question the dogma, like I was, you would have some serious repercussions. And as a matter of fact, when it came time for me to get tenure, in the mid-90s, the lady that led the charge against me getting tenure was a very, very dedicated, rabid feminist, because I wasn't on board with her ideology. And by that time, the mid-90s, I think universities had become a very, very significant part of the propaganda system. In other words, selling an ideology.
Right.
Facts aren't important. Ideology is everything. You come out of the class with the prescribed ideology, you get a good grade. You don't need information anymore.
No.
You need an ideology. And then, of course, environmentalism became the ideology of choice during the 90s. And then towards the end of the 90s, multiculturalism was the ideology of choice. This is who we are. You know, this is what
right.
we are. You know, you don't question what we are.
Right.
And so, you know, there's a lot of mind control in this, I believe. You know, I mean, all the Tavistock Institute of Human Relations stuff that goes back to World War I, and the Frankfurt School of Germany between the World Wars, and the Macy Conference meetings between the 40s and 50s. These are very, very smart, well-trained people who are figuring out how to create these paradigm shifts.
Right.
They didn't want an America that could think critically and that believed in, say, Republican form of government and believed in God.
Right.
They wanted to sweep away all of the old, you know, pillars of
right.
society in terms of who we are, and they wanted to redesign it, much as the mind control experts at the, you know, British warfare, psychological warfare division of John Rawlings Rees right after World War I. This is where this is coming from. This is psychological warfare directed at an entire generation and an entire country in order to weaken us and eventually, I think, create this paradigm shift. Which allows them then to really take us down. I mean, this is war against the domestic population. And if you read the documents that came out of the Tavistock Institute, they admit this. This is warfare. This is covert warfare against the domestic population. And so, you know, to be forewarned is to be forearmed. I mean, we need to know.
Right.
Who our enemy is.
Right.
You know, it wasn't really the Russians. The Russians, you know, all the years I was, the Russians were the boogeyman, or the
right.
Germans, or, you know, then Saddam Hussein. We're given all these boogeymen, but really all you need to do is go right to the world elite and their think tanks, like
right.
Tavistock and the Frankfurt School and the Macy conferences. And these people are extremely smart. And they write. And if you read what they wrote, it's all there.
Exactly.
You know, they admit exactly what they want to do, and they tell you how they're going to do it. For instance, you can go online and you can find these documents like Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, which
right.
was a document, I believe, out of the Rand Corporation in the 50s, which supposedly was used at the first Bilderberger meeting. A declaration of warfare against the domestic population of the United States. It was found inside a Xerox machine in the mid-80s, you know, unattributed, but it has been traced back to Rand, and it certainly seems, if you go online and look for this document, you'll see that these are not dumb people. These are the best and the brightest.
Mm-hmm.
So we're up against an extremely sophisticated enemy. And it is psychological warfare, and it is covert. And the New Age movement, of course, is part of it. So that's how I would start at least my end of this. If I'd be glad to hear what you have to say about this connection between the global warming hoax and the New Age movement.
Well, they've been working on this cultural Marxism thing since... Now, cultural Marxism is where they change society, the culture of society, to make it open for Marxism. And
yes.
they're doing that by confusing us, by the feminist movement, which started off to be a very worthwhile thing. I mean, when the First Awakening in the in the end of the 19th and beginning of the 20th century, we got women's suffrage and a lot of really good things out of it. And even in our awakening period, when you and I were going through the hippie movement, you know, there were some good things that came out of that. I mean, it gave people, it gave women more freedom and more stuff like that. But now it's gotten to be really so arcane that it's very difficult to express yourself because it's taking away language and that kind of stuff. Now, the Tavistock, I was reading a book, reading a new book by Daniel Esselin, and it's about Tavistock. And I focused on the part about Woodstock. Woodstock was absolutely and completely, from the elite's point of view, a mind control device. They kept people awake for 3 days. They kept them in the mud for 3 days. Poor sanitation, illness, satanic, what's his name? Adorno, what's his first name?
Theodore
Adorno's music, and they passed out LSD. So it was like obviously mind control, but I missed it. It looked so innocent. Everybody had jeans on and were getting naked and running in there. I mean, it looked like innocence to me. Now they have these Tomorrowland festivals that are all over the world, and they're music festivals, but the music is, it's like this techno rhythm. I mean, it's Dionysian, you know, dun, 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 for days and days. And if you look at the advertising videos on these festivals, which occurred in September as part of a ritual, you notice that it's all, the signals are there, that, you know, the butterflies, the free sex, everything is there. And you know that it's like the final, one of the final stages in the imposition of this cultural Marxism. We know that Tavistock started, no, was it 1938, something like that?
It actually goes right back to World War One. So 1920, 1921.
1920.
The close of World War One, Brigadier General John Rawlings Rees,
right,
who was head of the British Psychological Warfare Division, was given a huge grant and facilities to start this thing, this Tavistock Institute. Sigmund Freud was immediately right. enlisted, mm-hmm. who was, of course, one of the top psychoanalysts in the world at the time. And the assignment then became, let's study how the brain, the mind, can be fragmented by trauma. And they used shell-shocked soldiers who, you know, were basket cases. And they were not really interested in healing these soldiers. They were interested in figuring out how to fracture the mind in that way. And once they'd learned how to do it scientifically with individuals, they wanted to take the same principles and apply it to the culture en masse. Okay, this is 1921. Cut to 1953, when Alan Dulles gives a speech to a group at Princeton and says, you know, our enemies are doing all this mind control. We have to catch up to them. Well, that was a lie.
Yeah.
We were always ahead of the communists in this. But he said, what we want to do is control individuals by this trauma-based technique and then apply those principles to the masses. He said that in 1953, I believe in April or March or something, and then the next month he signed into being the MK Ultra project, which had 149 sub-projects in which the CIA then was doing all this scientific experimentation in hypnosis and testing all the drugs, including LSD, finding out that LSD was psychosis producing,
mm-hmm.
and it was a good war weapon. They tested it for 12 years before they unleashed it on the youth of America in places like Altamont at the festival in 67,
right,
and then Woodstock and the festival in 69. As you say, these are mind control experiments. They are psychological warfare.
Right.
There were many number of people killed at Altamont, one ritually on stage right in front of the Rolling
Whoa.
Stones while they were singing a song called
probably Sympathy for the Devil or something like that.
Sympathy for the Devil, yeah,
right.
And then this is all filmed. And of course, the Hell's Angels had been employed, and these are ex-military people. The Hell's Angels had been employed by the Stones to, you know, enforce security. Right. They were the ones that were beating these drugged out hippies with you know, pool cues that were, you know, were weighted with the, you know, real heavy things in them.
Right.
And there were many, many casualties at Altamont and Woodstock. And the thing about Woodstock is people were not allowed to leave. So
right.
They have a perfect, like you say, it's a perfect mind control experiment as well as psychological warfare. Let's see what happens to these kids. And what's so fascinating is our generation has bought into the myth that these were wonderful and liberating events. And there's so many people, you know, oh, Woodstock was a seminal movement for, you know, humanity and for our generation. And this mythology has carried forth. And now we're starting to see, as you say, this excellent book by Estelin on Tavistock Institute. Wonderful. I recommend it should be in every library in the world, I think. And then along those lines, I've just reread David McGowan's book, Weird Scenes Inside the Canyon.
Love it.
Oral Canyon, Covert Ops, The Dark Heart of the Hippie Dream. And this is very important reading for people to get the past straight, because we live in an Orwellian world where the past is constantly being rewritten.
Right.
This guy is an excellent investigative journalist who looks into the lives of these great stars like Jim Morrison and Jimi Hendrix. Turns out both of these guys were, you know, most of the stars in Laurel Canyon were the sons and daughters of people in intelligence or military. Jim Morrison, for instance, was the son of the admiral who was involved in the Gulf of Tonkin non-incident, saying that he was attacked when he actually was not even attacked. This became the pretext then for launching the war in Vietnam, saying we have to, you know, attack back. There was no attack by the Vietnamese.
Right.
They didn't have the technology hardly to attack one of our...
Details.
Yeah, it didn't matter because it was so far away. You just, you know, tell a lie on TV and you got a war. And anyway, so Jim Morrison's father was the admiral of that particular boat. And Jim Morrison himself, very, very probably, was one of many of these stars who had quote-unquote dissociative disorders. Well, the dissociative disorders that he would have had would have been a result of being enrolled in these MKUltra Project Monarch mind control programs when he was a child. So poor guy was subjected.
Right.
You know, and Jimi Hendrix, and right on down the list, many, many of these stars were in fact mind control victims.
Exactly.
Monarch mind control victims. Many of them were dead by the age of 27, like that's after ruining their lives on drugs and all those things. Morrison was dead by 27, and Hendrix was dead by 27, and many, many of the other stars. To read this book, David McGowan has a very kind of a good sense of humor, a dark sense of humor, but it's all in here, as well as a book by Schlein and some other guy called Acid Dreams, which talks about the 60s and all the mind control that was surrounding the drug culture of the 60s. So this was an attack, a covert attack on our generation. And so many people think these were the good old days. Yeah, there might have been some good things that came out of it, but we have to realize that, there's the process church. Charles Manson was one of these guys. And he was considered a good musician by the Laurel Canyon musician crowd. He partied with those guys. They liked him. And, of course, then he and his family, quote-unquote, a bunch of runaway girls who were often underage, and he was a cult leader in a true sense. I mean, he had his way with them sexually and in terms of mind control. And he himself was under mind control, so he would have been a programmer.
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking ritual murders. We're talking pedophilia, child molestation. We're talking intelligence agencies involved in this. The vast network, satanic network, really, was behind the whole Laurel Canyon scene. And this you can pick up through this book.
Right.
Now, what it means is that history needs to be reconsidered.
Exactly.
We need to reconsider the whole thing and see what the underlying forces really were.
Right.
And I have to speak personally, Paul. I'm a pretty good musician and always was. And when I was at Prescott College in 1967, 68, and 69, I loved this music just like everybody else. And
me too.
I heard the siren call. I was, Neil Young from Toronto said, we were going like lemmings. We were going like lemmings to Laurel Canyon. We didn't know why. It was like all of a sudden we had to go. And all these people from all over the country, young people,
right,
went to Laurel Canyon. They were accommodated. They would all of a sudden just kind of miraculously, serendipitously get homes and housing and money and instruments. And, you know, it was all facilitated. But they were just kind of like pawns in this gigantic game.
Right.
Well, as I say, I was very much drawn, but I stayed in college. And if I hadn't stayed in college, I might have gotten a couple paragraphs in here.
Right.
I might have been one of those stars who burned out young, you know. I don't know. But it's a very interesting time. And, you know, one of the things that the CIA was trying to do was to tinker with our memories.
Yes.
Well, music is pretty good. Music is pretty good for, you know, bringing us back to an earlier time.
Exactly.
So now when we hear Joni Mitchell or, you know, The Doors or whatever, we often associate that with things, and it's deep in our subconscious. Mm-hmm. I don't think this is an accident either, because
No. Now
we hear all these songs being played over and over and over again, and the purpose is to create some kind of a nostalgia for something, but we've been so manipulated it's hard to
Right. Know
what to be nostalgic about anymore.
Right. You know? The Summer of Love was 1969. That's what we saw it as, the Summer of Love. They saw it as a beta test manipulation. Let's see what we can do with these guys. Music itself is really interesting. Do you want to talk about Theodore Adorno? He was,
yeah.
Go ahead. He was from the Frankfurt School, I think, originally.
That's right, yeah. And there are some good quotes in this book about the Tavistock Institute where he says, we want to make a music that is so degrading that it's... that it's going to drive people crazy. This is what he wants to do. I mean, you talk about the cultural Marxism.
Right.
Cultural Marxism was, you know, Antonio Gramsci and whatnot of the 30s. They said, listen, we tried to take over the world with communism and the Soviet Union, and it didn't quite go as fast as we wanted. So we're going to have to try a new strategy. And that is the long march through the cultural institutions. And this is more like Fabian socialism now, mm-hmm, of the Brits. You know, instead of doing it abruptly, we're going to do it incrementally. So Gramsci and the cultural Marxists were trying to slowly subvert our cultural institutions. And, of course, music is a very, very powerful. It has, I think, a deep spiritual component to it.
Absolutely.
For good, it can elevate us, or for bad, it can really pull us down.
Right.
It can degrade us. And, of course, this is what they want, is the degradation. And they've gotten generations of Americans now to sign on to this really terrible music, which has gotten worse.
Yes.
It was pretty good at first. I thought, you know, but then, of course, it went into the really heavy acid rock by the late 60s, and then it just went worse from there, you know, and, of course, you know, this became a way to get the generations to fight because, you know, the younger generation wanted music that the older generation would hate, or at least that's the myth we're told, or that's one interpretation. So it had to get more and more outrageous until we're left, you know, with things that are just noise.
Right.
And, but the point is that Theodore Adorno anticipated this. And this is what he said years ago, you know, in the late 40s and 30s, that they wanted to do. So they've called their shot. They've said, okay, we're going to do this. They did it. And now we can look back and see, wow, these guys really pulled it off.
Fascinating topic. Most people don't know, I think Adorno wrote the Beatles numbers. I think Adorno.
This is what I've heard. So, and I know there's a guy, Alan Watt, up in Canada, who's a musician in Scotland, now in Canada. And that's his point, too, that much of the Beatles' music, or maybe most of it, I don't know, would have. Obviously, he was a very, very highly trained musician, as well as thinker. But with an extra grind, I mean, you know, these guys are not just out there to make good music. They're using music now as a weapon, as a cultural weapon.
Right.
And so, you know, I guess this is another thing we need to wake up to, is the power of music and how it can be misused, as it has.
Right. I think that, this is my own idea, it just seems really coincidental that during the 50s, Les Paul invented the electric guitar. Now, there's no instrument that gets right to my heart. You know, Lucifer, the angel Lucifer, was a musician. I mean, that was his deal. So they invent this electric guitar, which I love. I mean, I love guitar music. It just takes me, every Saturday we listen to Pink Floyd. I can't hear it enough, but I know that that instrument connected with that music is more powerful than we'll even let on to believe. What do you think about that idea?
Well, we're thinking along the same lines. In fact, I've recently purchased 4 copies of a DVD called They Sold Their Soul for Rock and Roll. Mm-hmm. And it's by a pastor in California by the name of Joe Schlemel, who himself was in the music industry and wanted to be a star. See, part of this, I think, is that, you know, we get seduced into this and thinking that, well, I'm as good as that guy, so, right, you know, maybe I can do it too. So everybody I know wants to be a star on the guitar, right, or whatever, you know. So there's lots and lots of people who would like to trade places with these people. But then you look at their lives, such as the book about weird seeds inside the canyon.
Right.
And you don't want to trade places with these people. These people are, you know, total wrecks as human beings. And, but yeah, the you know, he talks about in this movie, he's got a 3-hour version and a 10-hour version. And it's very, very, he uses lots and lots of examples. You know, there's Bob Dylan on, you know, being interviewed by Morley Safer saying he sold his soul to the devil.
Yes.
There's the quote by John Lennon that he sold his soul to the devil. There's the lyrics of Jimmy Page, Stairway to Heaven, which is one of the most popular rock songs of all time, which he interprets then as actually being Stairway to Hell.
Right.
And with all the imagery, and really does a good job of proving that that's exactly what that song is about. So he just takes you through so many of our heroes, really, and shows us that what they are fairly openly advocating is that we all go to hell with,
right,
them. You know what?
Yeah, what?
You know, it's like, you know, all these years, you know, these were our heroes, and now once we deconstruct this, we see that, you know, there's this satanic component, which, you know, goes back to guys like Aleister Crowley. You know, the fascinating thing to me, Paul, is that, you know, you go to the movie They Sold Their Soul for Rock and Roll, and Pastor Joe Schlemel will say, well, Satan did this, and then Satan did that, and this guy Johnson went to the crossroads, the first black rock and roll guy,
yeah,
and he sold his soul to the devil. I mean, that's in there pretty well documented. People said, yeah, he sold his soul to the devil, you know. When he left, he couldn't play the guitar, and when he came back, he was the best, you know,
right,
ever. You know, that was pretty good circumstantial evidence that actually happened. But then you read other books about mind control, and you realize that, well, gee, it's maybe not the devil per se. Maybe it's the CIA and all these trauma-based mind control, satanic ritual abuse that has fragmented some of these individuals as children,
uh-huh,
and that demons can be installed in them. So what's the difference? Well, I guess maybe that, you know, there's different ways that all this can happen. but that people can be possessed. Now, the whole idea of what they call theurgy, which is a word that I was not familiar with until recently, is summoning spirits.
Yes.
And much of what the New Age is about, and certainly the secret societies, has to do with gaining personal power by summoning spirits.
Mm-hmm.
Well, guess what? You summon a spirit, and you know you don't know who it is.
Uh-huh.
You know, he can say, "I'm a good spirit."
Right.
You know, "I'm a good angel." But as I am beginning to realize, angels and demons are smarter than we are. They haven't died.
Right.
They've been around a long time, and they can fool us, and they regularly do. For instance, John Dee, the Rosicrucian, who was the mentor of Francis Bacon,
right,
and who really supposedly set the prototype for the British Empire with Queen Victoria or Queen Elizabeth back in the old days, in the 1600s, he was a Christian Kabbalist. And so
yeah,
he was using the Kabbalah, and he was a genius. I mean, he had the biggest library in Britain. He was a geographer, he was a mathematician, he was a spy, the prototypical 007, and he was an advisor to the Queen. He set the template for how the British Empire would control the world. So pretty smart geopolitician. He was also a Rosicrucian, the first head of the Rosicrucians, or I can't say the first, but he was the head of the Rosicrucians. He was summoning good angels.
Yeah.
Right? Good angels. Well, I don't think that good angels are the ones that appeared to him. I think he was, the difference in white and black magic is, you know, supposedly white magic is you're doing it for good reasons, and black magic is you're doing it, you know, to harm somebody.
Right.
I think the line is very fuzzy, and people who think they're doing white magic can be fooled into doing just,
right,
you know, summoning demonic spirits. So this theme then keeps running into the New Age movement as well. And it goes way back to John Dee, and before that, I'm sure, you know, and of course Hitler and the Tools Society, there's so many of these secret societies.
Right.
That have under, and the Freemasons being one of the biggest screens for the others, these societies are controlling our political realities, including our wars, from behind the scenes.
Right.
And I think it's these societies then that would have created this hippie counterculture movement, and the New Age movement would have brought these ancient mysteries from Egypt and Babylon, this is really what's being delivered to us through this music and through these societies, and through the hippie movement. We're really being Satanized, and we have been Satanized.
Absolutely.
So we can't tell the difference anymore between, you know, God and Satan.
Right.
You know, so many of the Christian churches have been infiltrated. If you listen to Tex Mars, the evangelicals almost completely, the Southern Baptists, you know, are just almost hand in glove with Freemasons now. The Catholic Church itself is totally on board with this New World Order.
Right.
We have the New World Order Pope who's telling us about global warming and, you know, all this stuff. So, you know, they've lost their credibility. Now, there must be some good Christians out there. I'm sure there are, but I don't think they're in the mainline churches so much anymore, you know.
No, if you go to a mainline church, that's a prime way to get corrupted.
Yeah.
I like to talk about music in the 60s,
yeah,
and I do want to get back to that. But let's go back to H.P. Blavatsky.
Okay.
Because you've mentioned and you've written about that being the origin. Now, here's a woman. She's a Russian woman. She was raised in a... seems like she was raised in a Masonic library, and she was a scholar in that. And so she, having been contacted by spirits, now we can assume they're negative spirits, I think, since her original publishing company was the Luciferian Publishing Company. And she not only started the Theosophical movement over here, which is, I think, the beginning of the New Age, but she also went to India and in the East and tried to revive some of those old dying religions that were being replaced actually by Christianity at the time. Do you want to talk a little bit about the beginning there? I want to get back to this music stuff because it's really heating me up. But I know that
just a little bit about Blavatsky.
Yeah.
Interestingly enough, one of the first things that piqued my interest about her was she was also a spy.
Really?
And here you have the same combination, you know, with Aleister Crowley, he was a Satanist
yes.
and a spy. John Dee was a Satanist and a spy. So there's always this kind of political subterfuge going on next to the, it's Satanism, really. The spirit that she was supposedly channeling was the Tibetan Dwal Kul, and she wrote a number of books supposedly channeling the spirit. Alice Bailey, who then became the next leader of Theosophical Society, also channeled many books from the same spirit, Dwal Kul, the Tibetan.
Uh-huh.
And I have to tell you that my first inkling of this was when a friend of mine in Sedona, Arizona, brought me to a Sunday morning service. It was the Ageless Wisdom Society.
Oh, there you go.
And there was a guy walking back and forth on the stage, speaking in a monotone. And we you know, all chanted the great invocation, which goes back to Blavatsky, you know, to usher in the plan mm-hmm. on earth, you know. And it didn't take me long to realize that this guy was teaching Satanism. And I actually walked out of this group. There were probably 40 or 50 Sedonaites sitting in the pews, and the Society for Ageless Wisdom the guy was talking about, you know, higher levels of initiation, and
right.
people are being inducted into this as we speak all over the world in nighttime initiation ceremonies, etc. Well, this is, and of course he quoted Blavatsky and he talked about the Tibetan. Well, at the time I had studied Tibetan Buddhism for 10 years.
Yeah.
And I tell you for sure, I knew then and I know now, that the Tibetan doesn't know much about Tibetan Buddhism. So at the highest levels, these guys are kind of stupid. And this is what I'm finding out. At the highest levels, there is kind of an intellectual attenuation that goes on. You know, when you get into Blavatsky, she talks about root races, you know, and the mm-hmm. Lemurians and the blah, 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 you know. And then they start talking about the Arcturians, these people from Arcturus. They start talking about the Pleiadians, all this New Age stuff that has been in Crestone. This is wild, crazy stuff, and there's very little to no scientific basis for it. So, you know, for us all to get on board with the Blavatsky and the, you know, the root race, that, you know, we're the superior root race. Of course, Hitler loved that.
Right.
You know. Yeah, this is stupid. All of this is stupid. You have to be stupid or not well-educated to buy into this stuff. You have to be kind of egotistical. And the bottom line is they want us to think that we can be gods. And it's just like the serpent story in the garden, you know, surely you will not never die, and surely, you know, you will be as gods. Well, that's the whole basis of the New Age movement. You're going to be God. We're gods, you know, that they think. And we're going to live forever. Well, that gets into transhumanism, you know, because they're actually moving us to the point where we can merge our bodies, you know, with computer
right.
chips and whatnot. And that, you know, if that happens, I think it's going to be permanent hell for anybody.
Oh, I can't think of anything worse. Right.
That kind of immortality is going to be permanent hell. But anyway, yeah, the Blavatsky thing is a perfect New Age because there's a whole package of fairly crazy stuff that goes with it. So you have to kind of throw away your commitment to rational thinking to buy into
right
it. And of course all the other types of New Age that have come along kind of share in that pattern. But yeah, I think that's good to talk about Blavatsky, because she is a very enigmatic figure. She's a bit of a fraud. She supposedly said she could levitate and do all kinds of things, which many people say she actually couldn't. She did spend a certain amount of time in India, I guess, but it's hard to know because she was an inveterate liar. And so, you know, the beginnings of these movements are not very impressive.
No, it's now. I've got deeply into the New Age movement, as you did with Buddhism. Matter of fact, back in the 90s, I started a Waldorf school that was based on Theosophy and the teachings of Rudolf Steiner. And the reason I started it is because I had a young daughter, and I didn't want her to go to public school, and she was responding so well to a Waldorf Kinderhouse that she went to. So I know that it's rooted in Luciferianism and the New Age philosophy, but it seems that there are fragments of good in this, like the LSD that they passed out at Woodstock helped a lot of us see this stuff, you know, kind of backfired on them. What do you think about, how do we find our way through the New Age maze that's makes up so much of our society? What's good, what's bad, what can we chew on, what can we count on? What do you think, Eric?
Well, I think, you know, I was fooled by the Waldorf school too. I thought it was a better alternative than public school. I have friends that taught in it and friends that put their kids through it, and these are smart people. But of course, if you start reading about Rudolf Steiner, at a deeper level, you do realize he was very much into the occult.
Absolutely.
And there is a book called The Trail of the Serpent, written in 1936 by Inquirer Within. Evidently, at that time, it was maybe not safe to write a book like this. But she was a British lady named Christina Stoddard, and she was at a high level in one of these secret societies. And, you know, she talks about Steiner, and other people talk about Steiner, as himself being possessed by one of these demon spirits, just like Blavatsky and Bailey, the people that really, you know, want to get that extra power and horsepower,
right?
You know, by appealing to, you know, spirits in the next world, sometimes they succeed, and then they apparently, you know, seem very smart and prolific, but what's driving them is not really themselves anymore, I guess. You know, this kind of possession thing. And she talks a lot about this. Christina's daughter talks a lot about this in her book, Trail of the Serpent. And we're really talking about the worship of the serpent, which is, of course, one of the biblical symbols for the devil. And so, that puts the Waldorf experience in a whole different light.
Right.
And, you know, again, it's so easy to be fooled because, and again, in so many aspects of the New Age movement, we've been fooled.
Right.
It's very attractive. People at all levels of society, CEOs, people in intelligence work, people in government, they're fooled. And, you know, it's hard to, just about everybody's been enlisted in the New Age movement, you know.
Yeah, they have.
You know, it's like the people in Crestone. I think that they're well-meaning, most of them. And most of them, you know, are what Lenin would have called useful idiots, you know, because they can be used, because they can be fooled into aligning themselves with programs which are really not in their best interest at all. You know, it's like those people who are convinced, you know, those relatively poor people who are convinced to be Republicans, you know, and vote and vote for Republicans.
Right.
I mean, it's not in their interest to vote Republican, but they can be propagandized and fooled into doing so.
I think one of the things that, in my mind, one of the things that the New Age movement was most effective at and really did was stripping us of our morality and putting us in situational ethics. Whatever's right for you, there's no right and wrong, there's no good or bad, it's just how you interpret it, and from your side might be different from my side. And no, in my mind, no society can really exist amorally. What do you think?
I think that is so absolutely true. And, you know, one of the things that I've thought about, now, why would a MI6 operative who went to Cambridge, like Aleister Crowley, why would he push Satanism, which really was the template for the New Age movement and the hippies?
Absolutely.
As well as for 911, if you look at it. Why? Well, if the elite can get the masses to give up their morality, mm-hmm. and move towards chaos, which is what this immorality brings you to,
right,
towards, then they can authoritarian figures and establish their fascism. These guys are top-down fascists, eugenicists, who want complete control. And if you have a moral society, as I'm reading now, if you have a moral society that kind of polices and monitors itself, then those, then you can have, in other words, it's like freedom in Christ. There's some rules to be followed, you know, the
right.
Ten Commandments, for instance, you know.
Right.
But if you can do that or try to do that or get close to doing that, then the authoritarian figures don't need to come in and you know, lock everybody up and kill people off. Which,
right.
If you have a zero population, zero growth template that the leaders want to impose, that ultimately, zero growth means you're ultimately moving towards, as I read it in some of these books, you're ultimately moving towards a system of genocide and slavery. In other words, the human life is no longer worthwhile. We're just another animal responding to, you know, stimuli. And
right.
This is how these Tavistock people look at human beings. They're not, they're no better than animals. They're input-output machines.
Right.
They're always looking for just pleasure. So what you do is you fool them, you know.
Right.
And, of course, this negates the idea that we're made in the image of God and that... that human reason and human life is the most sacred thing, therefore. And, of course, that's what I've come around to, is that, yes, we are made in the image of God, and that in order to live a decent life, we need to follow some moral constraints.
Right.
Take those away, like the New Age movement, like the drugs, like the,
right.
you know, the counterculture, and what you move into is destroying you. People's lives and your own as well as others. So our generation perhaps has learned the hard way that these rules are there for a purpose, and they're there to make our lives and our society's life better. But throw away the rules and you have chaos, and then the leaders can come in and throw us in concentration camps, do whatever they want.
Exactly.
So I think that's one of the reasons why they promote this kind of chaos, because then they can come in and be the authority figure.
Yeah, I think that was a big motivation for the New Age movement, was to divorce us from our morality and put us in kind of a situational ethics kind of thing. So if you're looking at a New Age belief and you find that it's moralless, or it's teaching you that there is no right and wrong, I think that would be a good time to back out of it, because we need to remember. See, our generation fell hook, line, and sinker. I don't know whether you know the saeculum, but there's an ancient system, and it's from a book called The Fourth Turning. You would love it. It's by Strauss and Howe. They're two, I think, college professors, and they wrote about the saeculum. Well, we were born right after a crisis, you and I, and we were part of the baby boomers, which is also called the prophet generation. Now, the prophet generation in the 1960s to the 1980s, we went through, which is a natural cycle in the saeculum, which is an awakening. And our awakening was natural, and we were going to get civil liberties for everybody and end war, and we were really into that. Tavistock countered it with the hippie movement. And we started losing the morality that our parents and our parents' parents had that had got us to this point. And, you know, I look at things like the Tomorrowland festivals and other things that are going on today, and I have to think that we started it, our generation, our prophet generation, kind of, we were the ones that initially pushed it off into situational ethics. So that's one thing. If you're getting involved in any of these movements, I think you have to be grounded in some kind of morality.
Yeah. Well, speaking as somebody who studied Tibetan Buddhism and tried to practice it in Crestone, mm-hmm. and of course Boulder also was a center for Tibetan Buddhism. You know, in Buddhism, there's the three yanas, the three vehicles, the Hinayana, the lesser vehicle, the Mahayana, the greater vehicle, and then the Vajrayana, which is the diamond vehicle, the rocket ship to enlightenment, which is practiced by the Tibetan masters, and now they're here teaching. And the idea is that you're beyond dualism. You're beyond right and wrong if you're doing this kind of Vajrayana practice. So, you know, some students will just go out and, you know, drink and party and take drugs and, you know, have as much sex with as many people as possible, because the idea is that, you know, that they can kind of somehow transmute. They can get the energy from these activities and then transmute it by realizing the inherent emptiness of everything. Well, you know, you can see where that leads. You
right.
Know? That leads to very, very chaotic lives and very destructive, self-destructive lives. And, of course, I saw this with some of my, you know, fellow Buddhists. And I also saw that there weren't too many that were getting enlightened or even close, you know. So what it does is it just kind of moves people towards, you know, being really messed up. And so in that sense, you know, maybe a Tibetan master can do this stuff, but I don't think it's good for the West. I don't think it's good for Westerners to try to do this stuff now. I think it's foreign. I don't think there's any way you can hold that mindset or that worldview in your brain at the same time as you can hold a Western, you know, scientific worldview.
Right.
I think they're contradictory. And to hold contradictory ideas in your brain at the same time, of course, makes you double-minded.
Right.
And that's one of the things that the serpent people want you to be, is double-minded, because then you're unstable in all your ways, you know. And you know, snow is black.
Right.
And in the book Tavistock Institute, you know, you have Aldous Huxley and people like that saying, we want an education system that's going to teach our children that snow is black.
Yeah,
that's
who was the CIA director? I think his name might have been Colby. He says we'll know when our mission is accomplished, when the American people, everything the American people believe is false.
Yeah,
1981, he said that.
That was Casey.
That's right.
Casey, Colby. The Wall Street banker lawyer, and that was supposedly one of the first things he said at a briefing when he just took office. But yeah, these guys have us in a false reality matrix. Of course, they work for the elite, and this has always been the case for the intelligence agencies.
Right.
They don't work for the people. And so, you know, this is why they're so well paid.
Right.
And of course, they're above the law, too. You know, they break the law with impunity, and they do.
Right.
As we know, in the, you know, from the Church Committee Senate hearings in the mid-70s, they, between 1947 and 1975, the CIA had run over 10,000 illegal operations, every one of them illegal.
Right.
And, you know, deposing leaders in other countries, spying on college kids in America, paying journalists and professors to put out their brand of propaganda. I mean, you go down the list of all these heinous crimes that our CIA and NSA have conducted, not for the benefit of Americans.
Exactly.
But for the benefit of the bankers in Europe and America and Wall Street who run the world.
Exactly. Couple things I wrote some notes down about Buddhism. There is a educational program called Landmark Education, and it's a huge, I'm sure it's a product of EST, which came out of the Esalen Institute, and they teach you, one of their major platforms is life is inherently empty and meaningless.
Yeah.
And unless you give it some meaning, it has no meaning. It sounds just like Aleister Crowley saying, the whole of the law should be, do what thou wilt, you know. It sounds like that, too.
Yeah, well, the idea that, you know, it's the existentialist idea of Jean-Paul Sartre and those people that, you know, existence precedes essence. So we invent our own set of priorities, like you say, which gets right into do as thou wilt. In other words, and of course this gets into humanism, that man is the measure of all things. You know?
Right.
And humanism then is to be one of the prototypical religions, quote unquote, then for the New World Order. You know, take God out of the equation, let man be the measure of all things, then anything is possible, and it's just a matter of who's got the most power. Because if there's no God and man is the measure of all things, then whoever's got the biggest club or who's got the most money gets to rule. And that's, of course, what we have.
Right. So we're fragmenting our mind between humanism, where man can make his own decisions and run his own life, and being just another virus evolving over millions of years, and these viruses go extinct all the time, and there's no, you know, we're not that important. So it fragments you into those two different mindsets that are incompatible. It's cognitive
dissonance.
That's
a very good point. Yeah, the New Age movement on the one hand saying you shall be as God and you will never die. That's the old serpent's lie. On the other hand, the humanism, that man is the measure of all things. So, yeah, that would fragment you. Those are different paradigms.
Yeah.
And those seem to be dominant in our world today, in our country today, in America today. And you're right, they're not really compatible.
Yeah. Another interesting thing that you mentioned is this, the Buddhists having sex. I think sex is their major deal. I mean, they sell everything with it. They influence it with it. Totally corrupted society with it. I mean, it's, you know, we were growing up and during the awakening period, it was great, free love and all that stuff, but we didn't realize what was actually happening. We were being seduced into a sex cult. And sex became something other than a sacred act for procreation. It became a
recreation.
Recreation. Now it's almost meaningless. I mean, the way they've got it.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a sex and drug cult going way back to Egypt, you know, at that time. And of course, the Bible talks about this being the dominant world system at the end days,
right.
You know, the Babylonian Egyptian cult system. And yes, sex is right in the center of it. Unfortunately, this gets into some very dark stuff, you know, the idea of pedophilia, and let's face it, you know, for the trauma-based mind control, the satanic ritual abuse, which the CIA studied and expanded based on the Nazi work in the concentration camps, which in turn is based on the Illuminati practices that go back for thousands of years, all of this really starts with sexual abuse of a child less than six. From what I read, you know, when you're over six, if you have extreme trauma, then you have post-traumatic stress syndrome. You have shell shock.
Right.
Okay, that's been studied, you know, by the Tavistock Institute and everything. But if you're less than six, you're a tiny little critter, and you've been raped, well, you know, your identity hasn't really been established. So what happens is apparently that in order to survive this trauma, this ferocious trauma, you actually have another personality split off. And the people who know how to train, quote unquote, these people into multiple personality disorder, or dissociative identity disorder,
right,
as they call it now, they know how to take this new split off personality and name it and create an identity for it and create triggers that would throw the individual into those altered states. So you have a whole series of personalities, maybe hundreds or thousands even, within one personality structure.
Right.
And it is the occult knowledge that goes back thousands of years, which has been refined by the Nazis and the CIA and applied, I think, en masse, to our people in our culture that you can now create a robot or a zombie who can be triggered back and forth between these different subalter personalities if you need an assassin,
right.
The Manchurian candidate model. That person can be triggered into the killer mode and then triggered out of it so they don't even remember that they killed somebody.
Right.
And this describes some of the shooters like at the University of Texas years ago and Sirhan. And then others would be created as sex kittens like Marilyn Monroe, the presidential models. Their sexuality is enhanced. All of these people are victims of this trauma-based mind control with their children. So they deserve the utmost compassion.
Right.
And I believe, I think I said it last time, I believe a lot of these shooters that we're getting nowadays are victims of this kind of panic control abuse, trauma-based mind control. They've been split. They are controlled by outside handlers. Now, the handlers themselves may also be controlled.
Right.
So you have to go up the ladder to find out who's, you know, who's the marionette, who's working
right.
the marionette strings, you know.
Right.
And this was called marionette programming under the Nazis. Now it's the monarch program.
Right.
And this is one of the greatest crimes against humanity because free will has been robbed and destroyed. So what we're really fighting for is the future of humanity having free will.
Exactly.
Because with these technologies, with these techniques, the few can turn the rest of us into robots who will kill on command, who will give sex on command, who will be couriers, who will spy, all kinds of functions. So this is very, very dark stuff. And yet it's very, very, very real. And people need to know about it, I'm afraid.
Right. I think they're expanding that to the masses, too. I think they are creating an army that can be triggered through
yes.
the satanic ritual abuse and stuff. But I also think that it's happening with the general public. I know all over the world, the induction into public school is starting at younger and younger. Down here in South America, it's 4 years old. They want the kid in at four, which is what you said, under six.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how your elementary schooling was, but mine was traumatic. Leaving your mother, going in, and you know, the teacher is in some ways abusive, tough, and that could be part of it. Also, TV. I think TV has gotten so sophisticated that if you watch any amount of TV, you really, I don't think you can even have your own opinion because you don't know what's been downloaded into you. And you don't know if you might have a trigger. I mean, you might, there might be something that's going to come over your cell phone that was put into you on the TV that's going to start you marching in a direction that you don't want to go.
I see this so much. That's a very good point you just made about the triggers, and that's something I hadn't considered. But I see so many examples of individuals whose opinions have been manufactured for them.
Uh-huh.
And so you hear them spouting an opinion, and you know exactly where it came from.
Yes.
And, you know, this is a relatively well-educated person who's plugged into the media. And so they say the right thing at the right time. Well, it's an opinion that was delivered to them for them
right.
through propaganda and mind control. What you said about the triggering, perhaps even by the media, is a very interesting point because, yeah, this is what they've always wanted to do. They've wanted to take those trauma-based mind control techniques that were used on the individual and apply it to the masses. So I've never thought about that, but I think it's quite possible that those of us who are plugged into TV and movies are probably being manipulated in ways that we have no understanding of. For instance, I read just recently, remember the good movie Gladiator?
Yeah.
You know, Russell Crowe out there fighting and everything.
Uh-huh.
Well, apparently, during one of those fight scenes when he's fighting the emperor or whatever, subliminally, a little screen flashed very quickly that said Kennedy
yes.
during the actual battle,
right.
the fight. And this happened twice in the movie. And, of course, none of us remember that. because it flashes by so fast. They've known how to do that since the 50s.
Right.
But this subliminal goes right to your unconscious. And, of course, most of us don't really understand what the unconscious is about. And I'm one. I didn't take much psychology. I'm having to learn now. But, yeah, the unconscious is huge. And we often respond better to subconscious cues than conscious cues. Most people operate more on the emotional level, which is closer to the subconscious, I understand.
Yeah, I think that that's true. There was a, if I don't know whether you watch True Stream Media, but there are two people in Texas, actually, who are Aaron Dykes and Melissa, I can't remember her last name, but they're excellent. And they're humorous and they're great. And they've picked up remember when TV used to go off at night? They used to do these sign off exercises, and they play America the Beautiful, and they'd show a picture of a thing. It was in black and white, and you'd remember. Because TV didn't go on 24 hours, there were three stations, and they'd go off at 11 o'clock or something. Well, even during then, they have the words to the America the Beautiful, and the words kind of unfurl. But before the words unfurl, it's like, trust your government, obey. I mean, she's got it up on the website, and it's amazing. So even back then, the potential for TV was I can picture them being so excited, titillated, running around thinking about what they could do with this TV, because it's such a powerful thing.
And we all bought into it. Our parents bought into it. You know, I'm sure you were also, we were amongst the first wave, and our parents would sit us down in front of the Mickey Mouse Club with our mouse ears on,
right.
My brother and sister and I, in kind of a little line there, and I was the oldest, so I was the tallest, and then it goes down.
Right.
And we're all just sitting there, little sponges, with our brains open, being hypnotized by the Mickey Mouse Club. And once a year, we would watch The Wizard of Oz. Every year, we watched The Wizard of Oz. Well, now, that's true programming. In fact, a lot of this Monarch programming uses The Wizard of Oz symbols, as well as Alice in Wonderland and others. But for whatever reason, our parents bought into this thing, hook, line, and
sinker. Of course.
I don't know why. I guess it was the baby breathing.
Well, they didn't think they were being threatened by their government. They didn't realize that they were purposely being mind controlled. They were innocents, as we were sitting in front of Mickey Mouse Club, which is run by Walt Disney, 33rd Degree Mason, major operator in the whole New World Order thing. It's amazing. And even today, people are paying $6,000 to put a TV up on their wall that's known to mind control. It dumbs down children. Children have a decreased IQ, and also their attention span absolutely goes away. So when they go to the classroom, they can't pay attention.
Yeah.
So anyway, go ahead.
You go ahead.
I want to go back to the New Age movement and how disarming that is. We have most of the friends that we have are into the New Age and the New Age philosophies. And some of them are so disarming. I can really see where they would be very desirable by the dark side to put these in. One of the things is this is about negativity. Don't focus on negativity, because it'll bring it back to you. So, we tell them about things that are going on, about the Monarch programming. Well, they don't want to hear it because, you focus on that stuff, you're going to bring it to you. And it's very difficult to talk them out of this. And even though, if you go into it fresh, it's so ridiculous you can't even, it's absurd on the face. But once you've been conditioned into this, it makes you totally defenseless,
Yeah, and there's the movie The Secret. you know. And of course, Oprah Winfrey was into The Secret, you know. And you know, you what you're supposed to do, I guess, with The Secret is you think, and then you believe, and then you receive. So it's a totally irrational world. I mean, it's now you're being put into a fairy tale world where, oh, I'm going to think yachts, you know, and now it's going to somehow magically come to me because I've attracted it with my thoughts. It's like the universe is a gigantic, you know, Costco or a gigantic supermarket. Right. And if I think the right thoughts, it's all this good stuff's going to come my way. You know, this is magical thinking. And of course, you know, if you were to do a study, you know, this is a sad example, but let's say you have 20 people with terminal cancer and ask all 20 of them to think positively, just think of not having cancer and then just believe that you don't have it.
Right.
And just receive the cure. You know, I would be willing to wager that, you know, 0 out of 20 would be cured in that manner. You know, so there's no rational basis for this, but it is a magical kind of thinking that goes along with the New Age, and it's very common in Crestone, where I live. You know, this The Secret. You know, there's the movie The Secret, and you get these people that are just smiling broadly because they've learned The Secret, and now they get all this good stuff because they know The Secret, and you know, it's just all a load of garbage. I mean, there's no basis to it.
Right, but it's totally disarming. Eckhart Tolle, he believes that there's no right and wrong, it's all in your mind.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the New Agers walking around say it's all good. It's all good. Oh, how dangerous can that be? I mean, that's... Here we are, we're chanting, it's all good, whatever happens is good. Well, it's not all good. There's some horrible things happening. A lot of the stuff that was described by you, the satanic ritual abuse, the making insignificant of sex, these aren't good. We have to wake up and address them. And I think the New Age movement goes a long way. And I'm glad you mentioned Oprah. I think if you want to be deceived, you're going to be on the front line of deception if you watch Oprah. What do you think about that? Because she has.
It's quite possible. I don't watch Oprah, but I see little clips once in a while. You know,
she has all the New Age gurus on.
Yeah. Well, you know, she's a billionaire, and everybody kind of looks up to her because she's also, you know, a lesbian and. She's modeling a lifestyle which the elite wants to model. The elite very much wants, you know, gay marriage. They very much want to move us into an era where pedophilia is okay.
Right.
Because that's what they like. You know, somebody who likes members of the same sex, chances are, I'm not an expert on this, but at least with guys anyway, I think that there would also be a preference for boys. Well, this is terrible. I mean, this is life-shattering stuff. You know,
right.
You destroy somebody's life. And then, of course, the victim of that kind of pedophilia would then be likely to turn around and be the aggressor when he grows up.
Exactly.
You know? So you're passing on this very, very sick prototypical situation in society, which has to destroy the society. In fact, I understand, you know, you listen to a lot of people who talk about interpreting the Bible. One interpretation that I've heard from Tex Mars is that when God told, you know, the ancient Israelites to destroy this culture over there, sounds pretty judgmental and nasty, but one interpretation is that this culture was heavily involved in this kind of activity.
Right.
In other words, they had completely lost their moral compass. They were into this pagan, New Age, magical, black magical world, wherein they just basically destroyed each other with sexual perversions and other kinds of perversions. So, that kind of interpretation of the Old Testament wrath of God makes sense to me. I don't know exactly how it went down, but I think any culture that does that and makes a lifestyle out of that is going to be doomed. I don't see how a culture can survive that does that sort of thing. So the fight that's going on now, you know, between the, say, the Christian right and the left-wing people who want gay marriage, I think is very, very important and very real. And now that I'm of a certain maturity and age and we have a certain perspective, I would be on the side against the gay marriage and this very, very permissive lifestyle that so many of our leaders, like Oprah, embrace. You know, I just think it means the death knell of our country. And I think that's much too high a price to pay for somebody's individual freedom so that they can sleep with who they want. It always seems to come down to individual rights, quote unquote, versus the welfare of the larger society. And the New Age always seems to throw people towards the individual rights and to heck with society.
Right.
Well, we can't live without society. You know, if I can't go to the store and buy some food, I starve.
Right.
If I can't go to the gas station and get some gas, I can't go anywhere. So we are depending on each other at a very, very fundamental level. And when that breaks down, then, of course, the whole society is going to break down. So I see us becoming less and less stable in that sense. More and more rife for being destroyed.
I think you're exactly right. And I want to mention that both Eric and I are old folks. We've been around the block, and we were seekers. We tried to find it here, we tried to find it there, we tried to find it everywhere. And we analyzed. We didn't live non-examined lives. We looked at everything, and we've come to this in a rational way. We've come to this morality, not because we're old and crotchety guys, but because we've been there. We've tried it. We were part of the subversion of society. We both were. We both loved that stuff. But now we realize that the family is very important. And gay marriage is great. I think there's a problem in most... I think there's a problem with sodomy, just because of the way it's regarded by the Bible and the way it's regarded by the Satanists. It's a source of power by the Satanists. Aleister Crowley referred to the anus as a stargate through which he could, or the children he was dealing with.
Raping, whatever.
Would get a momentary glimpse of nirvana or something. So I think there's, and especially in the Bible, they talk about Sodom and Gomorrah. I mean, there's a town named after that act. I mean, there's got to be something that's somehow occult about it, or somehow. So it's tough. So when you're putting gay marriage on the same level as heterosexual marriage, which is the marriage that brought us here, it brought the human race here. It creates children. It gives a structure for educating those children. The gay marriage, they might be able to participate in educating them, but the way it is now with today's science, I don't think they can create children. Maybe they can. But I think that's why we really have to embrace maybe the morality of our parents more. Maybe we have to back out of this this cult mentality that we've been pushed into. What do you think, Eric?
Absolutely, I agree. I appreciate your comment. Yeah, you know, it's you could look at it and say, well, okay, people get more conservative in old age,
right.
You know, both in our 60s. But I think it is a rational progression for both of us. In other words, we have looked at the consequences of certain trends in society, and we've seen the positive and negative results.
Right.
I think we're both thinkers in that sense and observers and trying to be honest. So, yeah, the sodomy thing is actually very huge. This seems to be a basis for the satanic ritual abuse. They talk about, you know, opening the third eye even as a result of this. And, of course, if it happens when you're a child, then I think your ability to trust in the future is really reduced. I mean, there's a lot of anger that comes with that being violated in that way. I think you can destroy a child that way. There's a guy, a farmer by the name of Marion Knox, K-N-O-X, who's written on this subject, and he says this is the basis for mind control, sodomy. And you can go online and look him up, Marion Knox, and he's written a couple good articles on this. He's a Christian who likes to try to exorcise demons from individuals who have been fragmented in these kinds of SRA, satanic ritual abuse situations. And he has, I think, met with a certain level of success. You know, in the Bible it says, you know, if you're a Christian and you have Christ, you are kind of an ambassador who can drive out demons in the name of Christ. And some people would say, well, you know, a lot of people don't use that because maybe they don't feel, you know, authoritative enough. But he's one of those guys who does try to do that, and he says he's had a certain amount of success healing people. And it's this act of sodomy which gets them into the trouble in the first place. In other words, that's when the demons are installed, or that's the basis for the programming in which the demons can be installed. So there's something very strange about sodomy. It's very, as you say, it's unnatural, but I think that supposedly the Luciferians, who are worshiping, you know, the light bearer himself,
right,
Lucifer, talk about it being a way in which people participate in the light. Okay, so obviously you have the aggressor and you have the male and the female component in the act, and the male component will often do it as a means of you know, power, and the female component supposedly is kind of a certain light, a very black light, I'm afraid, is opened up in that kind of encounter. So I guess, you know, as you know, unsavory as the topic is, I think it's important to discuss this, because yeah, Sodom and Gomorrah, the Sodom was destroyed, and
right,
Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed by God for the perversions that were, by the fact that the whole culture then had moved into that. The whole culture had embraced it. This is, you know, a guy would not be turned on by a girl. He'd be turned on by another guy.
Yes.
And this is told in the Bible story. And, of course, God then destroys the town. And that becomes then the basis for the word sodomy. And what is the city of decadence in the last days? Sodom and Egypt, according to the book of Revelations. So you have the old system of sodomy and the Egyptian mystery religions, the occult mystery religion, coming up and making its appearance in the last days and taking over the end days,
right,
system. So yeah, this is something to be very, very actively resisted on a personal level, and to be fought at the level,
right,
of policy. Because from what I understand, you know, some of the gay groups in California, you know, have acronyms, you know, for their group, and you know, the Man Boy Association and things,
yeah,
like this. And they'll make statements like, you know, we're coming after your kids, you know. Well, I'm sorry, you know, I'll shoot you first, you know.
Right.
I mean, seriously, if I had a son of that age and someone came after my kid, I'd shoot him. I'd kill him. And that's, I believe, what he deserves. You know, I think there's a
right,
biblical precedence for that. So I don't think it's okay. I don't think everything's cool. I don't think, you know, you can just be non-judgmental.
Right.
And your truth is truth. My truth is my truth. No, and if that's your truth, you know, we got a problem.
Right.
And that is, you are destroying the society that I live in. And so I can't go along with that, you know.
Exactly, and it's not something that we just came up with. I mean, it's something that we're going through this with all of you. With all of you out there, we're trying to figure this out. And with our probably 150 years of experience between the two of us, maybe not that much. I'm older. This is what we've come, and we find that the New Age movement is so disempowering. It you know, there's a new phrase that now that they always say, grow a pair. You got to grow a pair, and that means grow some balls. And I think that's really what we have to go back to, what got us here, and the response to pedophilia is force. I mean, you can't sit by and let your society go that way and have no consequences. I think one of the things that the New Age has taken away from us are definitions of things like demons. Every other culture in the past dealt with demons. They knew what they were. Our culture doesn't know demons. The devil, taking that away. Well, there's bad people, but they're not. Yeah. So I think we've kind of been disarmed in that way too, and we're trying to struggle with a lot of things that are coming into our culture, and one of them, I'm going to throw this in and see if we can jaw about this for a while, because this is something that I think the whole culture of the U.S. is working on, and Europe. We have another culture being superimposed on ours, on our Christian culture, which is the Muslim religion. Now, I can understand being tolerant of other people's religions. Matter of fact, that's what we've always been, is tolerant. But we're bringing in a type of religion that's not only not that tolerant, but it also enshrines pedophilia and sodomy as being important functions in that religion, because the men and the women are kept separate, and when a boy gets up, he gets to be 12, 13, 14 years old, and his hormones are raging. There's no women around, so he turns to the younger boys. It seems to be a pattern in that culture that I think's incompatible with the Western morality that we're talking about. What do you think? What's your ideas on this subject?
Well, absolutely. I think that there is a full-on assault on America and American values and American identity. You know, we have all of these illegal immigrants here, you know, 40 to 50 million of them. We have programs now in which Americans are actually enlisting people in foreign countries to come to America as refugees, and then, you know, they're taken care of. And
right.
So pretty soon there's not much left of a dominant culture or a dominant worldview of that culture. And yeah, part of what the CIA does, it seems to me, is to start wars in all parts of the world, and then, you know, gang up with some of the local most corrupt elements, such as they did with the Laotians, who were part of the heroin trade,
right,
in the Golden Triangle during the Vietnam War, and the Hmong specifically were a tribesman in Laos, and they, you know, were selling heroin to the CIA that was supplying it to our troops in Vietnam. One-third supposedly were hooked on heroin at one point. And then after the war, the CIA, you know, facilitates bringing all these Hmong into this country. Same thing's happening now in the wars in the Middle East, that the CIA and the, you know, the British and various intelligence agencies have, and the Israelis have concocted. And so then these refugees now are pouring into this country from Syria, etc.
And so, yeah, we're getting a lot of foreign languages, a lot of foreign religions, a lot of people added on to America, which is, of course, making it impossible then for us to have a coherent culture anymore, right, or coherent values. I would say the Muslim culture might be part of that, but not certainly the main thing. But you know, right where I am now in Texas, you know, in the Rio Grande Valley area, there's about 80-90% of the local Americans who are from Mexico.
Right.
And you don't have to go very far till you read that you know, there is the Aztlan strategy for at least many Hispanics, which is that they want to take back Texas,
right,
over to California, because it was briefly theirs, you know, prior to the Mexican-American War in,
right,
1848. And by golly, they're going to outpopulate us in this area. So pretty soon, you know, Mexicans outnumber Americans now already in California, and
right,
will soon in Texas. And pretty soon they could just vote to secede and become part of Mexico, you know.
Right.
So the whole Republico del Norte movement, or Mecha movement, of kind of, you know, Hispanic nationalists that would like to see the southwestern United States reintegrated with Mexico. This could happen in the next 20 years, you know, or 30
right,
years. You know, I think what the Balkanization of a country, this is what the CIA and the intelligence services are now trying to do to Russia, and have been for quite a while. You know, just split off this and split off that until there is no coherent Russian empire anymore.
Right.
Well, Putin is resisting that, but Obama, on the other hand, he's you know, he's not resisting anything. You know, he's a complete puppet of these guys. So, you know, I find myself again in my older age, my older years, you know, wanting to preserve America and wanting to preserve the values that were associated with it. And, you know, to do that, I would say hold on to the Bill of Rights and hold on to the Bible. And again, the morality aspect, of course, in the Bible, and the Bill of Rights, the actual rights of the individual, are sacrosanct and still the law of the land, even though our government doesn't pay much heed to it anymore.
Right.
So yeah, I think that there's lots of ways to balkanize and therefore destroy a country. And since America is now the superpower, I think there's a lot of you know, attention being focused on how to take us down,
right,
culturally, politically, every single way, economically. It's kind of sad, you know. We're not quite a dead carcass yet, but I think that, you know, the powers that be, the international bankers, would like to carve us up like we were.
Right.
And so, well, you can have this, and you can have that, and here's the foreleg, and here's the hindquarters, and, you know, we're just going to, you know, consume the wealth,
right,
that was once America. It's very sad, but I think that Americans can fight back by educating ourselves and each other on you know, what these intelligence agencies and elites have been doing for so long. Again, I put a lot of it going back to Britain, the British, the Tavistock Institute.
Yes.
We were once a colony of theirs, and I think they want to see us return to colonial status, you know.
Right.
And these are ways of making that happen, you know. So, yeah, America is very beleaguered. But, you know, I'm down here now in the southern part of Texas in the Rio Grande Valley, and there's about a million winter Texans every year that come down from the Midwest, I understand. And these are people, you know, from Nebraska and Iowa,
right,
and
right,
even Canada. And, you know, these are good people, you know, and they're pretty solid citizens with values, you know. So I'm not quite ready to throw in the towel and say they've won, you know. They're doing the same thing to Europe, as you say, you know, with,
yeah,
the third invading and being encouraged to invade European countries, so we're all one thing,
right?
You know, give us all, you know, let's interbreed all the races, and let's take all the religions and, you know, just kind of scrap them, and we'll have a new religion, which is the Babylonian Egyptian system of paganism. This is what the elite wants. And so therefore, I think, again, we have to resist that. We have to say no. It's not a good idea.
Exactly.
My thing.
That's very good. Very, very well said. I think that, you know, they're doing this divide and conquer thing. And if we can wake up, the U.S. that I grew up, yes, I was deceived. And yes, I was tricked a lot of different ways. And I fell for everything. But it was a unique time in history when we felt like we were free. There were economic opportunities, and you know, you could believe whatever you believed, and there was a lot of creativity going on. And I think that's a worthwhile thing to preserve. But what they're doing now is this divide and conquer. There's the liberal censoring our language, and then there's the Muslim group, and then there's the Black Lives Matter group, and then there's all these groups. Then there's the Raza group in California that's trying to break away. I think they all really need to realize how puppeted they are, that George Soros doesn't care about anybody's lives, let alone black lives, that the Raza, It's the North American Union is kind of a fact already. So the fact that the Raza wants to succeed from the Union, well, there's not much of a Union left unless we all get together. And the divide and conquer thing, we've got to see that for what it is, and we've got to start right away. I really like to hear your, kind of at the end here, your summation on the dangers of this new age culture that's taken over Crestone Baca. And weren't you saying that Crestone Baca could be the center of this new world religion?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, Maurice Strong was the guy who acquired the Baca Spanish land grant ranch in the 80s, and he's a Canadian very high in the United Nations, who started so many of the environmental programs, including wrote the terms of reference for all the research into global warming. And he's the guy who organized the Rio Earth Summit and the Rio Plus 5 and the Rio Plus 20 and the Stockholm first international conference on these topics in 1972. So that's, you know, 40 years of being a key player in the environmental movement. And when he left the Manitou Foundation that his wife has run to be a kind of a international spiritual United Nations. The interfaith dialogue, what we see is that, you know, Christianity is, again, being divided and conquered, first with all these bogus Bible translations 100 years ago,
right,
and then the ecumenism movement where we merge all the Christian faiths under the umbrella of the Catholics, and then the interfaith where we get a compromise between Christianity and Buddhism, which is, you know, not going to be either one of them, really. It's just going to be this Babylonian pagan religion. I see Crestone as being kind of a petri dish. I absolutely believe it's a CIA MI6 operation from the get-go. This is really important to the Council on Foreign Relations to have a one-world religion. It's so important that, you know, Henry Kissinger has been appointed as the chief liaison advisor to the Pope. Henry Kissinger, you know, the guy who, you know, was Secretary of State and National Security Advisor under Carter and Ford. And the guy who prolonged the Vietnam War by an extra 7 years, you know, with behind the scenes negotiations with the North Vietnamese. The guy who's a total Rockefeller and Rothschild agent, Illuminati agent, if you will.
War criminal.
So I see Crestone as being kind of an experiment to try to get this new world religion going. And, you know, there is a definite new age component to that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's right on target, and we really have to watch out for that. I'd like you to go over your websites again, because they are incredible sources of information. This man does excellent research. Everything is documented, and it's total string of logic. You'll be so inspired when you go to his websites, because he's figured stuff out that we really need to know now as we come into this awakening. Eric, would you go ahead and do that?
Yeah, thank you, Paul, for that. And I just say that every time I go into one of these areas, I find people who've been there before me, and I'm quoting from them, and I'm learning like crazy. So I'm picking and choosing research that other people have done, other people with courage and intelligence. So I don't claim any special breakthroughs, actually. Mm-hmm. I'm more of a kind of assimilator of others' research in these areas. So my websites are 911nwo.com, which covers, obviously, trying to figure out what actually happened on 911 and how it relates to the New World Order. And in that website, I have this series of articles about Is Crest on Baca, the Vatican City of the New World Order, an expose of the New World Religion. Another website, which is equally large, is naturalclimatechange.us, which talks about the global warming hoax and how climate actually changes cyclically, naturally. And there is a political agenda behind this hoax that has to do, again, with the imposition of this New World Order system, or the One World Government system, with the UN as prototypical mm-hmm. One World Government. Then I also have an website about the issues of the water, the huge groundwater resource in the San Luis Valley next to Crestone, where I live. That's called Water Watch Alliance, and it was in that waterwatchalliance.us. And in that website, I realized that this guy, Maurice Strong, who was, Mr. Clean Environmentalist in the UN, was also had other hats, including, head of oil and gas and water right. corporations, and was a billionaire from making all this money in these pursuits. So very much working both sides of the issue. And then finally, I have a website that features some of my own music on guitar and banjo and piano, and that's just my name, erickarlstrom.com. So those are my four websites. They've kept me busy since I've departed from the traditional academic environment, but it's been in those last several years that I've really probably learned the most about how things really are.
Right. Well, it's quite an awakening, and I'm looking forward to going on. I haven't gone on the music site yet, but I'm looking forward to that. I think we could probably do a whole other interview about music and how they've used that, because it's really been used. I've been playing around myself with coming up with a site that has music at the correct frequency, hertz. I don't know whether you've gotten into that at all, but I'm gonna play around with that.
I think we could have a very good interview on that, and this guy, Daniel Estelin, who wrote Tavistock, talks about how frequency is at the basis of all everything. And music is, fundamental to who we are. And again, like you said, perhaps also fundamental to who Satan is. So, this is a powerful subject, and I'm interested in it. I'm still learning about it. I love to play it. I hope that my music is inspiring and encouraging. I know there's a lot of music that it takes you in the opposite direction.
Right.
So it's a powerful thing. And I'm not a famous guy. And I don't think I ever will be. I think the power structure, Satan is the prince of this world, the ruler of this world. And I think that the kind of music that he's promoting is not very good for us.
I think so, too. I think it got us into the situation, and maybe, just maybe, music can get us back out of it again. Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you very much, Eric. This has been a great interview. I can't wait to get this on YouTube, because it answered a lot of my questions, And maybe
it's a very interesting conversation we're having, Paul. I appreciate what you're doing and all the thinking you're doing, and appreciate the opportunity to talk to you about these things. Thank you.
We need insight from people who've been around the block like you, and because we're in a bit of a pickle now, and
absolutely
we need
absolutely.
To figure it out. Thank you very much, Eric, and I'm looking forward to other interviews in the future.
Thank you, Paul, and me too, and happy 2016.
Okay, bye-bye.